Good morning. Thanks to Vanessa and all the organizers. And I am happy to be again here with you to share our experience and what I'm doing to do in the next 20 minutes is to try to introduce some fundamental concept about the role of a cerebellar disease in CDG. We know that the cerebellum is a part of the central nervous system, and the word cerebellum means little brain. And this explains why the cerebellum has so many functions. The most important and the better known functions are in motor control. We say that the cerebellum is involved in coordinating the movements and in learning skilled voluntary movements. But it is also involved in maintaining the postural control, that means the ability, for example, to stand, and also in equilibrium processes. In addition, the cerebellum has very important higher cognitive functions, for example, in visual spatial processes, as well as in attention and in language, and in so-called emotional reactivity. This is a functional map of a cerebellum, and it consists of a narrow medial region called vermis and two lateral highly convoluted hemispheres. The inner part of the cerebellum belongs to the spinocerebellum, and it is involved in motor execution through connection with the periphery by the spinal cord. Moving from the inner part to the lateral area, the cerebellar hemispheres are more involved in cognitive processes, the so-called procedural learning. For example, to learn to ride a bike or to ski is dependent from a good function of cerebellar hemispheres. The ancient portion of the cerebellum is here, and this is the vestibulum cerebellum, and this ancient portion strictly controls the eye movements and also the equilibrium. What happens when there is a cerebellar dysfunction? There are some general clinical terms that define this condition. The most common sign of a cerebellar dysfunction is called ataxia, a Greek word that means a lack of order. That means that there is a difficulty in coordinating in a smooth way all body movements in all body compartments. For example, children with CDG have a various degree of cerebellar ataxia that, in addition to hypotonia, that means a reduction of a muscle tone, make difficulties in reaching standing position or to walk in a smooth way. Another cerebellar clinical signs is called dysmetria, that means the difficulty by a limb to reach a target in a space in a smooth way. Finally, also ocular involuntary movement, for example, the nystagmus, are very common in cerebellar disease. The cerebellum is a target organ of a CDG, and we recently reviewed this topic. We know that the CDG are genetic conditions due to an improper synthesis of the glycan moieties of protein and lipid, and that the nervous system is affected in almost 80% of these disorders. The cerebellum is systematically, regularly affected in patients with PMM2 CDG but also in a Dolly Call biosynthesis defect, the SRD5A3 CDG, and in all mannosylation disorders, the gastroglyconopathy that are congenital muscle dystrophy with an important central nervous system involvement. But cerebellar involvement may be seen also in patients with other different types of CDG. The cerebellum in CDG is affected in the form of cerebellar atrophy. Cerebellar atrophy means a reduction of a cerebellar tissue in presence of an initially normal cerebellar structure. As you can see here, this is a brain imaging of a normal cerebellum with respect to cerebellum imaging in a patient with PMM2 CDG, where you see a reduction of the cerebellar parenchyma tissue. The cerebellar atrophy occurs in a wide number of genetic diseases, and there is a great clinical and genetic heterogeneity. If we consider all these CDG, genetic diseases with cerebellar atrophy, we know that almost half of patients with cerebellar atrophy of genetic origin have no diagnosis. We can classify the cerebellar atrophy of genetic origin by a clinical criterion that is the age at onset, and the CDG belongs to the cerebellar atrophy disorders with a very early onset in ages. The radiological appearance of a cerebellum in CDG includes the cerebellar atrophy we discussed already, but also we can have some atrophy in other brains, central nervous system structure, in particular in the so-called pontine bulge, that is this protuberance here that reduce over time in some patients with CDG, usually in the most severe affected patients. Another radiological feature of patients with the CDG is so-called bright cerebellum, because in some images, the cerebellum cortex appears bright, hyperintense. PMM2 CDG is the most common among N-glycosylation disorders, and we know that the cerebellar signs occur very early, as usually unusual jerky conjugate oscillation of the eyes in very young children. Later signs include truncal titubation when sitting, and gait, ataxia, and also some slurred or telegrammatic speech. It is important to note that the cerebellar involvement is the most constant feature of PMM2 CDG, and it is very important to reach the diagnosis in many patients. We recently reviewed the clinical files of Italian patients with PMM2 CDG, and we tried to analyze the clinical feature with respect to MRI results, and also the genotype and the glycosylation profile of these subjects. What you can see easily here is that among 37 studied subjects, 21 had a more severe neurological phenotype. They were all patients unable to walk without assistance. And in these patients, the degree of cerebellum atrophy was severe, with often a very large posterior fossa cyst, this here, while in another subgroup of patients, 16 subjects, the neurological phenotype was less severe, and this was associated with a less severe degree of cerebellar atrophy, and all these patients were able to walk without support, and they had also a less severe intellectual disability. Therefore, we can argue that the degree of cerebellar atrophy is a good predictor of functional performance of these children. In addition to PMM2 CDG, the SRD5A3 CDG is another form with almost constant cerebellar involvement. This CDG is due to a defect in the synthesis of dolichol. That is a very important molecule because it acts like a shuttle that transfers the sugar to the Nascent glycoproteins in several steps of the N-glycosylation pathway. Eva Morava reported a large series of these patients, and they had developmental delay, a visual impairment often due to ocular malformations, and a variable degree of cerebellar atrophy, as you can see here. But in this slide, I won't remind that a cerebellar involvement is constant in the two CDG types we discussed already, but it may also occur in many other CDG types along the N-glycosylation pathway. Also, for example, in the later stages of N-glycan biosynthesis, in the so-called Golgi apparatum, and we recently diagnosed a patient with SLC35A2 CDG that is a defect in galactosylation of a glycoprotein. This condition is particularly important at this time because it belongs to the CDG with a possible therapy with sugar addiction, the galactose in this case. And this patient had developmental delay, severe epilepsy, in particular in the first years of life, and variable systemic involvement, and a variable degree of cerebral, but also cerebellar involvement. As you can see here in this Italian patient, you see a severe involvement of the cerebellum that remind the so-called Dandy-Walker malformation. Now, when we have a CDG patient with a cerebellar involvement, the most important question we feel is how can we find a predictor of outcome of this child with the current knowledge about cerebellar involvement in CDG? As CDG are rare diseases, we can learn more by analyzing other genetic disorders with cerebellar atrophy. And through this analysis, what we know by now is that an isolated cerebellar atrophy, that means cerebellar atrophy without any other brain malformation, has a better prognosis with respect to cerebellar atrophy that belongs to complex malformation syndrome of the central nervous system. Also, it is important to note the possible progression of cerebellar atrophy through time, and finally, the extent, the degree of cerebellar atrophy by using some radiological parameters. So we need to better standardize the clinical functioning of the children with CDG and cerebellar atrophy, and many things are moving towards this aim. We heard already from Dr. Serrano that some instrument, the ICARS tools, are helpful to objectively measure the rate of ataxia in these children. The French group with Dr. Monin recently reported the use of another scale, the SDFS, to measure motor disability in these children. And we think worth also to discuss the use of a scale that are able to measuring what actually the children is able to do. And these are the so-called ability of daily living scales. Some of these scales have already been used in children with cerebellar atrophy, and as we have already heard by Professor Patterson, it is very important to apply in tools that have been already used in special cohorts of patients. And so there are some scales that measure the ability of daily living that can be results very helpful to measure the overall functioning in children with CDG. In addition, we need some specific, more specific radiological measure. This can be obtained by a strict close collaboration with the radiologist. This is an example that we have in one of our patients with PMM2 CDG, and the radiologist used already known parameters to measure what is called the transverse cerebellar diameter and the craniocaudal height of the vermis and some other anterior posterior measurement of this structure, the brainstem, that is very close related to the cerebellum involvement in CDG. And this can be helpful parameters for predictors because we know from other children with cerebellum disease that there is a very good correlation between the size of a transverse cerebellar diameter that is correlated with the functional outcome in children with cerebellar atrophy. Finally, another important point is represented by the natural history of cerebellar volume loss in children with CDG. We know of a rare documentation of a normal cerebellum appearance in the prenatal and newborn period. But we know also that the cerebellar volume regresses within the first month of year of life. And this is an example in one of our patients of MRI at the age of 9 months and 7 years. It also through that the cerebellum signs seems to remain almost unchanged over many years thereafter. This cerebellar tissue loss is mainly due to the progressive reduction of neurons in the cerebellar tissue, as has been demonstrated by pathological studies in the cerebellum of PMM2 CDG newborn. And this emphasize that glycosylation is very important both for cerebellum development but also for the maintenance of a neuron in the cerebellum over the time. To conclude, by now, to improve our knowledge about the cerebellum involvement in CDG, we need more natural history studies in patient cohorts with the CDG. And from the studies already available, for example, we know that less than half, but almost half patients with PMM2 CDG acquires an independent walking. And this is a concept, I think, that was quite difficult to imagine many years ago. We need clinical assessment tools by a systematic application of both standardized scales and radiological cerebellar measurements. And also we have to try to find out association studies between clinical and genotype and glycophenotype in this patient. These are all people deeply involved in CDG, working at the Children's Hospital, University of Catania. Professor Fumara is here, and we will hear her tomorrow. And there is a huge amount of collaboration with colleagues at the Council National Research for the mass spectrometry analysis and characterization of the glycan profiles, in particular Luisa Sturiale and Domenico Garozzo. And we thank long-standing collaboration with Professor Yaken and colleagues at the Catholic University in Leuven. Thanks.